So my name is Nancy Fraser. I am a professor here at the New School for Social Research in the philosophy department and in the politics department. I've been here for a long time, but before that I taught at Northwestern University, and I have also had a lot of international appointments here and there. I work on critical theory, on social theory, political philosophy, and especially things having to do with feminism, the critique of capitalism, and things like hegemony, identity politics. I'm especially interested in the current political situation, and I'm trying to help develop some theoretical conceptions that can illuminate that and guide us as we seek to figure out how to respond to what's going on.
Yeah, and that's what we want to talk about is, sort of feminism for this political moment.
Right.
So to begin with, in your call that you signed along with many other folks for the women's strike on March 8th, you called for a feminism of the 99%. So
right.
I was hoping you could talk about what is a feminism of the 99%.
At one level, it's a kind of a reaction to the drift of feminism, especially in the U.S., but not only, into what I think of as some kind of a dangerous liaison with neoliberalism, and that the mainstream feminism in this country has become really a corporate feminism, a lean-in feminism, crack-the-glass-ceiling feminism. It's given up any broad, robust conception of what gender equality means or what social equality in general means. And it, instead of equality, it really seems to be focused on what I would call meritocracy. And that is just removing barriers that prevent the talented 10th or whatever to rise to the top in the corporate hierarchy, in the military, and so on. The kind of feminism that I've always supported, and I have to say I'm a child of the 1960s in this respect, is a feminism that is about abolishing corporate hierarchy, not about helping a small smattering of women rise up in it. But feminism has taken this neoliberal turn, this drift, for a good 20 or so years. This is not, for me, a question simply of something terrible has just happened with the election of Trump, although that certainly is very bad. But I think there's a much larger, underneath the tip of the iceberg, a much longer set, a bigger set of circumstances having to do with structural aspects of our society that have been ignored in all but, let's say, relatively marginal left-wing feminist currents with which I personally identify, but we have not, until now, I think, had much of a platform where our voices could be heard. Maybe we have Donald Trump to thank for the fact that it's a moment where more radical voices can be heard. And it just seemed like after the huge mobilizations and the great upsurge of anger and desire for activism and resistance and so on, and manifest in the January 21st women's marches, it seemed like this might be an opportunity to offer a different direction to US feminism. Like I would call it a course correction as opposed to simple resistance.
Mm-hmm.
The January 21st marches were great. There was tremendous energy and fantastic numbers and so on, a lot of creativity. But I have to say that they were somewhat politically inchoate. I mean, there was not a sort of clear direction, and maybe that's why so many people felt they wanted to participate. But it's also possible to develop a form of women's activism that has a clearer profile, a clearer orientation, a platform, and that I think in this context can start attracting broader support, because there's so many people, young people, older people, who are becoming radicalized and politicized for the first time, who throughout the Barack Obama presidency were kind of in a low-level funk. I mean, no one really wanted to oppose the first black president and so on and so forth, and of course he did some things that we could call progressive, but there's been a little bit of a damper on activism. And now I think the lid is off,
mm-hmm.
and there are new opportunities. And so we wrote the strike call for March 8th as the specifically U.S. response to the broader international call, which has endorsed by more than 30 countries. Mm-hmm. And we thought, let's seize this moment and see if we can get a left-wing feminism, a radical feminism. That's what we mean. For feminism for the 99% is for all the women, for which lean-in feminism has done virtually nothing.
Yeah. And I want to explore a lot of the ideas that you just laid out. The first is along with this idea of lean-in feminism or corporatized feminism, mm-hmm. you also write about progressive neoliberalism.
Yes.
Right? And so can you talk about, you talk about the beginning of the end of progressive neoliberalism. What do you mean by progressive neoliberalism, and how do you see that moment as the end, the beginning of the end?
Right. I was struggling for a long time to figure out how to characterize this drift that I just described of mainstream feminism into a sort of a corporate mold. And I need to add right away that I would say the same thing about every progressive social movement. This is not uniquely a problem in feminism. It's a problem in anti-racist movements, which also have a kind of black elite political machine cast to them, at least until Black Lives Matter erupted. I think we have a sort of corporate neoliberal wing of the ecology movement that is pushing green capitalism. We have within LGBTQI movements, we have all kinds of quasi, it gets gays in the military and into corporate life and so on and so forth. So this is the drift of American society. I have to say, in the US, we have this culture of individualism, of voluntarism, of pulling yourself up by your bootstraps, and if you don't make it, it's somehow your own fault. So this is the normal drift of things. It's only really in periods of overt crisis that Americans have a real incentive to start to think structurally about how the society works and how it is set up from the get-go. Bernie Sanders had beautiful language. It's a rigged economy. It's a rigged society. It's a rigged political system. That's all true. But to understand that, you have to really be able to spell out the structures that introduce that situation. Anyway, I've been observing and writing about this sort of neoliberal drift in social movements for a long time, but somehow the last US election, the campaign, all brought it into a very sharp focus for me, because I think Hillary Clinton was such a perfect embodiment of this. Mm-hmm. And then it all came together for me, and I just said, aha, what we have in the Clinton versus Trump matchup in the election, mm-hmm. is a contest between two horrible choices, which I called progressive neoliberalism and reactionary populism. And I came to understand that what has been the sort of ruling hegemonic bloc in the United States for at least since Bill Clinton took office in 92, it's a long time, has been this unholy alliance between these mainstream corporatized currents of the new social movements and certain sectors of the US capitalist class. It's not everything, but it's those parts of the sort of business world that rely not on manufacturing, but on sort of symbolic and cognitive capitalism, as it's been called. And that's Hollywood, that's Silicon Valley, and sort of the big elephant in the room, of course, is Wall Street and finance. And finance has become such a huge part of our economy and driving out other parts. So that's what I meant by progressive neoliberalism, the way this sector of the corporate world was able to create a kind of progressive cover for policies that are actually destroying the livelihoods and the forms of life, the families, the communities of working class and poor Americans, and really eating into middle class people's lives as well. I don't mean to just put it all to the, you know. Anyway, that I called that progressive neoliberalism, and I would say that the 1-2 punch, of course, Trump's victory, but also the remarkably successful campaign, successful beyond anybody's expectations, of Bernie Sanders, who came very close to knocking out Hillary Clinton with all of the sort of apparatchiks and, you know, levers of power that she had at her disposal. That was a very powerful, let's say, upsurge, uprising against progressive neoliberalism. One poll from the right, one from the left. Okay, unfortunately, the Trump poll triumphed, but it kind of blew the cover off of this hegemonic alliance, and I think that's what has opened the way to the current mobilizations. And I should add one last point to this. I have lots of fears, but one of my fears about what's happening now is that, absent a strong and clear left intervention, mm-hmm. all of this resistance, which is enormous, will end up reconstituting progressive neoliberalism in some new form with some more, shall we say, palatable figurehead at the top other than Hillary Clinton, who I think is just basically finished, politically speaking. That's one of my fears, and it's to sort of try to head that off, that we wrote the strike call in the way that we did, and that we are trying to organize this kind of left-wing feminism. I frankly would like that to be a model for other social movements. I would like to see various anti-racist coalitions develop around a similarly radical program, anti-racism for the 99%. Why don't we have that? For the gay, lesbian, queer, trans movement, for the ecological movement, I think that that this is the direction. And Sanders, who was, you know, by no means the perfect figure, sort of charted out a path here. Mm-hmm. Whether it stays within the Democratic Party or not is a whole other question. But he gave a language that helped sort of rip the cover off of what the Democratic Party had been up to, mm-hmm. for example, for the last 30 years. And I feel that we are kind of taking that opening that he helped to create, and that in his own perverse way Trump is helping to create, and we're gonna try to run with it. And as I said, I would love to see other social movements do something more or less parallel and connected.
And along those lines, Joanna Brenner wrote a critique to your article where mm-hmm. she talks mm-hmm. about the union bureaucracy being one of the reasons mm-hmm. why labor and social movements weren't ever mm-hmm. able to converge.
Yeah.
Can you talk a little bit about how you see the role of labor and particularly the union bureaucracy mm-hmm. in this feminism of the 99%?
Yeah. This is a kind of an old story. As with all social movements, including what has been historically the most powerful movement in the U.S. and in many other places, the labor movement, there always are sort of pressures to hegemonize the movement, incorporate it somehow into the system. And, you know, this is a long story of the rise of the so-called business unionism, which limits labor's orientation to improving the situation within the system, better wages, shorter hours, safety, and so on, all of which is perfectly good. But when it becomes an end in itself, and especially when the labor movement stops in a serious way trying to organize the unorganized, this becomes a problem. And then if you factor in something over which the labor movement itself had very little control, and that is the sort of profitability crisis in manufacturing in the higher wage countries, which created enormous incentives for outsourcing and relocation of manufacturing to low-wage regions, including for a while to the U.S. South, it must be said, where there's no tradition of unionism or not much of one. That was a context in which this business as usual strategy of business unionism really became problematic. For one thing, it degenerated into an attempt, and it must be said not a very successful attempt, to sort of defend what began to look like the privileges of what a declining percentage of the US working class that were unionized against the claims of, equally valid claims you could say, of the much broader stratum of working class people who didn't have that. And so there are always these labor aristocracy sort of elements, and those I think came to the fore, and then you got all these horrible deals where one set of better pension and wage benefits would be saved for already employed union members, but new hires wouldn't get those, would get something appreciably worse. So, I mean, already this doesn't look like a very progressive form of unionism any longer. And on the other hand, there has been a tremendous, even though it's very difficult now, there was a big upsurge in organization among public sector workers and among service workers, as opposed to manufacturing. And in a way that makes sense given the drift of our economy with departure of manufacturing and the bigger chunk of the weight of the economy going to the service sector. And that brought also a different population into unions, many, many more women, many more people of color, although one should not assume that manufacturing unions did not have people of color, that's not true. I feel that there is significant, there remain some very important and currents within the labor movement that I consider very much the allies of the kind of politics that I'm trying to promote, whether it's communication workers or other workers that endorse unions that endorsed Sanders and so on. So I'm not writing off the labor movement by any means, but basically, one thing that was it's sort of hard to put all the blame on the union bureaucrats, although they deserve a lot of it. They did not control the votes of their rank and file, many of whom voted for Trump against the union line that they should vote for Clinton. To me, I'm not saying that Clinton was no better than Trump or whatever, but these are two awful choices, reactionary populism, progressive neoliberalism, and that the labor movement has gotten caught up in one side or another of these, with maybe the bureaucracy still tied to the Democratic Party, including this neoliberal form of the Democratic Party, and the rank and file increasingly defecting and going to wherever they sense there is some commitment to change, but without necessarily having a clear grasp of the choices of what kind of change.
Yeah, and also I think along those lines, the union bureaucracy doesn't control the sort of leaders or the figureheads of the feminist movement who I think were able to be co-opted to varying degrees into the sort of corporatized feminism, supporting the Democratic Party, even supporting Hillary Clinton.
Right.
So, you know, in Fortunes of Feminism, you discuss the fight for recognition isn't inherently anti-capitalist, right?
Right. And neither is the fight for redistribution. I mean, there are system conforming versions of these as well as
mm-hmm.
other versions. Yeah. But,
yeah.
But go ahead, I didn't mean to interrupt.
No, of course. And so, you know, it needs to be linked to an anti-capitalist struggle.
Right.
So I guess what do you see as the political consequences of this division, you know?
Yeah.
What do you see as the way forward in that sense?
Yeah, well, I would sort of step back historically for a moment and just to sort of contextualize these terms, redistribution and recognition, which have been key terms for the way I've tried to understand these developments for, again, many decades. To me, the term redistribution was already, let's say, a kind of compromise and in a sense an alternative to socialism, or maybe it was socialism light or something, right? It's the socialism that dare not speak its name. So in other words, when labor movements and other radical movements, socialist movements, when they were contesting the basic ground rules of capitalist society, the property relations, the appropriation of surplus, et cetera, they were not really talking about redistribution. They were talking about structural transformation. Redistribution is a term that developed, I think, within social democracy, and it really does assume that the problem is unjust distribution of sort of divisible goods. It's not about changing the basic ground rules, so to speak. I would say that after World War II, this redistributive paradigm became dominant in the US, but also in wealthy social democratic countries throughout the world, and indeed in many developmental states that were not so wealthy, newly independent states, but that were trying also to develop, as they say. And certainly important currents of the labor movement and of the left, of the social democratic left, jumped in and took up this redistribution thing. Now the problem, I mean, there are several problems already, as you can see, but an additional problem is that this was a period, that post-war period, in which that redistributive model began to feel too constraining. And we're in a wealthy consumer society. You have Betty Friedan writing about, you know, the housewife stuck in suburbia. You have the beginnings of a new left that is against materialism and the consumer ethic and all of that. These are aspirations for things different from just fair distribution of income, wages, jobs, and so on. You've got the struggle against Jim Crow and so on, and these are beginning to trench on some deep structural questions. I mean, to raise the question of African American second-class citizenship and poverty is to already lift the cover a little bit on some very nasty aspects of American history, which are not in the past altogether. So what happened, I think, in response was a second paradigm developed alongside that dominant redistributive one, which I and many other thinkers have called recognition, in which the issue is not just I want to be equal, but I want you to recognize and approve and validate my specificity. I don't have to be like you. I don't have to live the life of a white straight man in order to be a validated, full member of society. All of which is perfectly good in a sense, except once again, history has all these surprises for us, because the moment in which the sort of recognition paradigm was developing was also the moment in which, let's say, declining Fordist capitalist model is running into its difficulties, and it's the moment in which the economic base is being cut out from social democratic redistribution. So there's a sense in which you got two parts of, I hesitate to use the word the left, but let's say what the closest thing we had to a left, two parts of it that seemed to be butting heads. So Thomas Frank, for example, writes about this, you have a sort of this world of the sort of declining manufacturing, especially but not only white unionized workers who are really feel quite threatened by the rise of claims in a situation where their livelihoods really are declining. It's not like they're, you know, sitting pretty or anything. And then you get this idea that relates to the progressive neoliberalism idea. You get the idea among the sort of recognition people, oh, those workers are just so backward. They're so deplorable, as Hillary Clinton called them. They're so, you know, they're racist, they're misogynist. And I wouldn't deny that there are elements of racism and misogyny throughout our society. But the situation is more complex and can't be understood exclusively in these, I would say, moralizing tones of voice. We have to understand that it's the unfolding and, let's say, the transition from one form of capitalism, the state-managed social democratic form, to another, the financialized neoliberal globalizing form. It's that transition that is sort of creating these strange bedfellows and very unhelpful antagonisms among populations that might have otherwise allied.
Right. Yeah, absolutely. And then I'm going to come back to, you know, the current moment, the Trump administration. So, you know, the Trump administration and around the world, we're seeing a rise of nationalism. Right, and one of the important aspects of your call for the March 8th strike is the fact that it's international, it's an international call. Mm-hmm. And so I want to think about why it's important to build an international women's movement, but also how building an international, a really internationalist women's movement can perhaps prevent the danger that you were talking about of the co-optation of the Democratic Party in the sense that, you know, the Democratic Party is an imperialist party.
Very much so, yeah.
And so, and even Bernie Sanders, and the more progressive seeming end of the Democratic Party, is still puts forth some of these imperialist ideas. So how
is even a little bit more nationalist, which is, I mean, neither imperialism nor American firstism, exactly.
Yeah.
Right.
So,
yeah.
Can you talk a little bit about the way forward to build an internationalist women's movement in the U.S.?
Well, I would say, first of all, that I think every progressive and transformative social movement really has to think internationally. The left has believed this for, you know, a couple of hundred years, at least given lip service to it. But I would say it's even more pressing today than it ever has been, because the capitalist world system is so much more globalized now. And because, I think that even, let's put it this way, even to the degree that one does want to talk about what national policy in a given country should be, you have to start from the realization that what is possible at that level depends very, very heavily on what the global international financial architecture of the world system is. So, for example, what made national social democracy, which was more or less internally egalitarian within a wealthy country like the Scandinavians or whatever, what made that possible was the Bretton Woods capital controls. And once those were dismantled, that kind of social democracy, relatively egalitarian if restricted social democracy, and it's true that it is part of the reason it's possible too, is it's siphoning value off from the global south. It does rely on a certain kind of imperialism. But all I'm suggesting here is that the national and the global or international are very tightly connected. And that would be one argument for, unless we think about how to rein in global finance, and that can only be done through a global social movement, global effort, our ability to do anything at a more local level will be very, very constrained. And then there are things like climate change. I mean, that's obvious, cannot be tackled by local activism, however much you reduce your carbon footprint here or there. So, I mean, there are issues like that that can only be addressed at the global level. And that, and what is the global level now? The global level now is Davos. It's, you know, it's the WTO. It's the TRIPS intellectual property regime. It's et cetera, et cetera. So what is the sort of left counterpart that can challenge those institutions? I was very heartened at the outset when the World Social Forum developed, because it seemed to have its sights trained on that level. There were problems which we can talk about if you want, but not maybe necessary to make them front and center here. But I just think it's very important to think globally now. And on the other hand, everybody is where they are and is living the crisis, the multiple crisis, the ecological crisis, the economic, financial, social, political crisis, that we're all living this where we are in our distinctive ways, and therefore we are all responding and reacting and becoming angry and becoming mobilized around things that are close to us. What this international strike does is really encourage solidarity and mutual learning. I mean, one thing that was very striking to us when we wrote the statement that appeared in The Guardian was this language that the Argentines were developing. They had such a terrific, expansive, and structural understanding of what violence against women encompassed. It wasn't just all on a bad dudes, you know. And we just sort of took that as a kind of a mindset for how to think about violence against women in a way that really addressed the 99% of women. And I just think that people have a lot to learn from each other. No one has the whole picture. And it's very exciting to see these mutual endorsements. And one thing that's happening with the march is that organizing groups from different countries are videotaping their events, and we'll be showing each other videos of each other. And so I think it really does create a sense that there's something going on, that we are a part of something much bigger.
Absolutely. So do you want to say any sort of last words about sort of the way forward for us, for the women's movement and so forth?
Well, I think I pretty much said what I have to say. I mean, maybe I'll just add one point. In my view, the structural basis of women's subordination in capitalist society is the division between economic production and social reproduction. Such a division never existed before historically. These activities were all kind of mixed up together and in the same place and so on and so forth. I think although the way that division has been drawn and made operational has changed significantly in the history of capitalism as it moves through a series of different regimes of accumulation. Nevertheless, this is for me the linchpin, and I would say any feminist politics that is focused exclusively on either of those two poles without paying attention to their deep imbrication and interconnection will not actually be able to deliver emancipation to women.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.